With all the talk of the deficits that we're entering and the stimulus bill and all the money that's being spent on the bank bailouts and potentially the auto bailouts, the question that everyone's asking is this going to lead to inflation? And that is what I hope to address in this video. And I guess a good starting point is, well, what is inflation? Well, it's a general increase in the price of goods and services. So, you know, they actually measure it by they take a basket of goods and services and they see how those prices compare to a reference year. And if those prices go up by 3%, you know, they might use a consumer price index. They'll say inflation increased by 3%. So that's what's inflation. And the opposite of inflation is if things actually get cheaper, is deflation. If 1 year a 10 megabytes of RAM costs X dollars and then the next year it costs a little bit less, it's actually a deflationary process, at least in that market. So with those definitions out of the way, let's talk about a little bit about what causes it. A couple of days ago I made these videos on cupcake economics where I talked about what happens when the cupcake factories have high utilization or low utilization, what that might happen with prices. And the reason why I did that is because I really wanted to make it very clear that it really is utilization of factories or of people that drive prices. So if I have, let's see if this is all of the capacity that I have. And when I talk about capacity in this video, I'm speaking in very general terms. It's all of the goods and services that we could produce. We could just talk about labor capacity, and then unemployment rate is a measure of what is essentially not being utilized. But let's just talk about that this is just our capacity, our productive capacity. And that those cupcake economics videos, I show that if the demand is pushing up against capacity, let me do demand in a different color. If demand is really close to capacity, and I know everything I draw kind of looks like balance sheets, but this isn't intended to be a balance sheet. This is intended just to show you that demand is pushing up against capacity. So in this situation, let's say, you know, this is capacity. If demand is at 90% of capacity, then the people with the capacity might say, gee, instead of trying to just try to sell that extra unit, so this is demand, instead of just trying to sell that extra unit and have to worry about all the raw materials and have to work for that extra unit, why don't I just raise prices? Right? So high utilization, let me write that down. High utilization of capacity, it leads to prices increasing. And this isn't some kind of fancy macroeconomic principle. It's true if you're running a lemonade stand. If all of a sudden you're starting to sell 95% of your lemonade, you'll probably say, hey, maybe it's worth it if I raise the price. On the other hand, low utilization, let me pick another color, low utilization will lead to prices dropping. And you go back to your lemonade stand and you say, wow, you know, if I'm only selling 20% of the lemonade that I make, maybe my problem is that my lemonade's too expensive. And frankly, if there was a bunch of lemonade stands, everyone is trying to sell their capacity. So just to compete with each other, they'll all lower prices. And actually, I'll throw another thing in here that's a little unrelated to inflation, but high utilization, it makes prices go up, and it also makes people want to add more capacity, right? So it also investment goes up, both of those things to add more capacity. But we won't worry about that right now. So if you accept that, and I think it's a reasonable argument because it's really based on, I think, common sense things, then I think you'll buy the argument that if you have very low utilization, it's difficult to have inflation. And likewise, if you have very high utilization, it's hard to avoid inflation. And to kind of hit the point home, I took our company's Bloomberg terminal and copied and pasted these charts here. And the orange, I know you can't see it that well on YouTube, so I'll try to make it clear with my drawing. But this orange, and I'll do it the same color, this orange shows capacity utilization. And the starting date right here was, I think it was 1967. 1967, this is 1969, roughly 19, December 31st, 1969. So this is 1970, beginning of 1970, this is beginning of 1980, beginning of 1990, this is 2000. This orange line represents capacity utilization. So up here, this is 90% utilization. And then down here, this is 70% utilization. So if we look here in the late, what is this? This is the late 60s right here. We had very high utilization. arguably because of the Vietnam War, we had factories running at capacity to build bombs and Agent Orange and God knows what else. And then utilization went down. You know, we could talk a lot about the history. But in general, the interesting thing, well, actually, before I go into kind of what happened, let's think about what this white line is. So the orange line is utilization. Up here, we had like 90% utilization. Very recently, this was like 2007, we had 80% utilization. And then very recently, utilization has dropped off, which essentially means we're not, you know, running our factories at full tilt. This white line is year-over-year inflation growth. Let me do that in white. This is year-over-year inflation growth. And actually, let me draw a zero line so we can separate inflation from deflation. So let me see. Zero inflation is right over here. That's zero inflation. And you see in this time series that I've done it, we've never had zero inflation, although we have had periods of very high inflation. But the interesting thing, just falling into the cupcake economics and this whole notion of capacity utilization, is that inflationary periods are always preceded, at least all the data I have, by increases in capacity utilization, right? So this is kind of, you can view this, let me see if I can mark this up. You could view this as the beginning of a pretty significant uptick in prices, right? And notice, it was preceded by an uptick in capacity utilization. So if you saw right here, wow, capacity utilization is starting to go up. And actually, another interesting thing is to see what threshold of utilization starts to trigger inflation. So over here, you say, OK, when inflation really started turning around, we were at a capacity utilization of roughly, I don't know, 83-84% right there. And then if you look at the next period where inflation really started to hit, you could either pick that point or that point, where was capacity utilization? It was around that same level. It was right there. It was above 80. This is about 82%. And then we could pick every period before that. So like, when did inflation, well, you know, since then, inflation really hasn't been a major problem. You know, these are our two major bouts of inflation in the early 70s and in the early 80s. And those were when we had extremely high capacity utilization. Right, extremely. So the point I want to make here is capacity utilization really is the driver of inflation. And you actually could find it the other way around. So this white line here, you don't see it because the orange line, oh, actually, I realize that I'm showing you off of the screen. But let me actually reduce my window so I can show you. So this is more recent, where we see that capacity utilization started falling off. I think this is in the summer of 2007. And you don't see it there because it's overwritten, but the inflation line has also dropped considerably. It comes down to here. But notice once again, utilization dropped off, although here it's pretty close, but utilization dropped off a couple of quarters before inflation dropped off. And that's why I always wonder why the Federal Reserve Board of Governors, they always talk about different inflation indicators and what to do about interest rates, when you do have a pretty good indicator, and that's capacity utilization. Now the next question that everyone has, okay, fine, Sal, you know, capacity utilization drives inflation. We can all buy that. But clearly what's going right now is kind of just a wholesale printing of money. And won't the wholesale printing of money drive demand to go up? And then you will have very high capacity utilization. And then we'll have inflation or even hyperinflation. And my argument there is that's normally the case. Normally, if you increase the money supply, normally, if the money supply goes up, that should increase demand. But there's a subtle, and it's almost a philosophical point, but it's an important one to realize. Money just allows you to express demand, right? Let's say I really, really want to buy a Rolls Royce. I just don't have the money. If someone gave me $200,000 into my pocket, then I could express that demand to buy the Rolls Royce. On the other hand, let's say I have everything I need. I'm happy with my Honda and, you know, my two-bedroom apartment, and someone gave me $200,000. So they've increased at least my money supply. Will that increase the demand for the Rolls Royce? No. I have money to express demand, but I won't do it just because I don't think it's necessary. So you can make that same analogy in the economy as a whole, where you can imagine an island where, let's say there's, you know, there's five of us, or let's say three of us, because I don't want to draw five people. And between us, we use seashells as a currency, right? And we're very confident, and, you know, maybe I'm the builder, and this guy's the fisherman, and she's the, I don't know, she's the farmer, and then I use, in, let's say in 1 year, I use a seashell to get some fish, and then he uses that seashell to buy some crops, then she uses that seashell to buy a house, then I use that seashell again to buy more fish. So you can see that one seashell, even though my money supply on that island is one seashell, it can transact many times on that in that year. So the velocity in this example is very high, right? So you notice that my expression of demand happens in these actual transactions. And I'll go to kind of the classical money supply equation soon. But you can imagine another reality where for some reason I stop trusting this guy. I become very cautious and I say, well, you know what? I don't want to give him my seashell because I'm not sure if I'm going to get that seashell back again to do something else. So you can imagine a reality where, you know, the central bank of our island, all of a sudden they find hundreds of seashells and they put seashells in everyone's pockets, you know, so we're all full of seashells. But all of us have just lost so much confidence in the economy or so unsure over whether other people are going to use my goods and services that I don't want to use their goods and services. So we all just start hoarding seashells. So this is a situation where the money supply could actually increase pretty substantially, but since no one wants to express it through demand, it's not going to increase utilization. And so in the situation that we're in right now, if you're wondering about whether you're going to see inflation or deflation, my argument is, look at capacity utilization. People can point to the money supply. They could say that, oh, you know, money supply, and this is the classic kind of money supply equation, that the money supply times the velocity of money, that's how often the actual dollar switch hands, is equal to the price of the average price of goods times the total quantity of goods and services we have. So most people say, wow, if the money supply increases, then won't prices increase? Well, that would be true if you assume that velocity and quantity are constant. But we're saying, and whenever you have major shocks and people lose confidence, this velocity can slow down considerably, especially when things like financial intermediaries start hoarding money and people start putting money into their mattresses. In fact, oftentimes people don't even consider things that aren't being transacted money. For example, those commemorative coins that they sell on TV, they are not considered part of the money supply because people don't use them as money. Anyway, I'm all out of time. I'll continue this discussion in the next video.